When was it? We had a party somewhere, a dinner party, and then we opened the door, and the man called over was having a party on the other side.
Yeah, that's true.
And then we just joined. Might as well have a big party.
That makes sense. Yeah. I guess that Denmark has actually gotten a little further right wing. We had a conversation in
the world has.
The world definitely has.
Yeah, that's the thing. Yeah.
Well, we had a conversation in Toronto, and you just mentioned
the Syrian part of refugees the, and all that. Yeah, yeah. And I remember that, you know, they were walking up the highway, and, you know, people were afraid of them. Some people were helping, you know, but, you know, and I thought I've seen the, at that point, seen the worst of the world, but I guess we didn't.
Yeah.
No.
Was it surprising to you that Denmark has continued on this path of moving further right?
No, it's not surprising. It's disappointing. But it's the same here. You know that. You know it's. I wish we was wiser. You know that. Mm. It seems like we've forgotten what happened, and it's also the, you know, makes the movie so much more relevant that, you know, we seem to have forgotten what happened 70 years ago.
No.
How people treated each other, and we still point fingers and judge each other. So it's pretty, yeah.
Mm. So is your new movie any happier?
No, not really. I wouldn't say no.
So this is your area of expertise is depressing and
yeah,
I pain,
maybe,
human agony?
Maybe it is, yeah. Maybe it is.
So when you were a little kid, we talked, I guess, about when you made this movie, but what got you into filmmaking in the first place?
Maybe because my mom always, she was a single mom, she always put me in front of the television, so I just sat there and looking, and my father left me when I was very little, when I was three, and I always dreamt about him coming back, and so I always made up these stories about, told my friends what he was doing, even though I had no clue, always make up these lies about, so I think, you know, in as a person, I just evolved into this storyteller because I wanted, I needed some story of knowing what where he was or what have happened or I think that was it. And then movie making was a coincidence, maybe. I actually was surfing for a lot of years. And then I found out I wasn't good enough, so I started filming the surf competitions, and then started editing, and then...
So you wanted to be a professional surfer? That was your hope?
My ambition at one time, yeah. I never made it, though, so, yeah.
And is that a significant sporting activity in Denmark? Is that something that people do?
No, but it's like it was a, like, you know, people skate and they surf,
right.
And they, especially when they came out in the 80s, it was a popular sport. I've been through all the yo-yo and the BMX and the electric boogie and the breakdance, but surfing was something that stayed.
So you started shooting the competitions like a documentarian?
Yeah.
And that became a business at some point?
No. It never became a business, but it made me go into a film school where I started editing, and then slowly just started writing as well, and started making my own stories and wanted to tell stories.
And was that kind of ambition considered a wild, you know, chance to do something when you were that age? Or, I mean, we talked actually the filmmaker who made the short that's nominated from Denmark. And he was basically still not making a living making films. He's hoping to in the next year or two.
I wanted to be an editor and make a living out of that.
Uh-huh.
And I did that, and I did edit for a long time. And then slowly I just started writing my own stuff, actually. And me and my wife did a documentary in New York City. And we basically did that to have something to shoot for her. She's a cinematographer. She's also my cinematographer for Land of Mine and my new one, to get work, you know.
Mm. You hear that with actors a lot. I don't hear it too many times with cinematographers and editors.
No, if you don't get the jobs, you got to shoot it yourself.
Yeah,
you gotta,
I guess so.
Invent it yourself. And then and then slowly just evolved into to.
So the world was smaller for you, I guess, than for a lot of people. You weren't staying at home and trying to figure out a Danish film to make. You were in New York. You were in other countries.
Yeah, and in Denmark also. I worked in the beginning. I worked as a bricklayer, construction worker, financing whatever we wanted to do. And
So, is Land of Mine kind of changed your career trajectory, or?
I with my first movie Applause, I started to slowly make a living of it, and then my second one was. But definitely, it changed a lot, the Land of Mine, and gave me a lot of opportunities to work and do what I want.
And that's ultimately the ambition, is to do what you want,
do the things you want to do. Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Is it easier to find stories as the world gets a little darker, or?
I mean, it's funny you say that, because we were a group of Danish filmmakers sitting around. I don't know whether it was 7 or 8 years ago, that we lived in such a safe country, and there were no stories, and you know, all the movies were about divorces or family, small stories, you know, not necessarily unimportant stories, but smaller stories that
and we like said, applause.
Yeah, and we almost said, oh, I wish we were living in more difficult times, so we could, and we definitely got that now. So no complaining about not being able to find the stories anymore.
I was having that conversation yesterday with some female filmmakers from the U.S. saying how, you know, that time of the early 70s in America we made great films because of the Vietnam War and Kennedy being assassinated and all that, but we really don't want to have to go through that cultural part again to get good films.
No.
It's kind of horrifying when you think about it.
Yeah, it is.
So this film is, I mean, the story of the film was that you were looking for just an idea?
No,
I've been through the Danish history?
Yeah, I've always been interested in history, always read a lot of stuff, especially about the Second World War, because it's such a big topic, of course, but also, you know, Denmark always portrayed themselves as the good and helping nation, you know, helping the Jews flee to Sweden, and we always hear these Good Samaritan stories, but everybody knows that there is something deeper in there, and so I felt over this story by coincidence. I was actually googling about the Danish Pioneer Corps, which was supposed to clear the mines, and I thought maybe there was a movie there, and then I found out that they forced the German into it, and then found out that it was German boys, and then eventually it just evolved into a movie.
So was there any pushback at home when you made this?
What do you mean?
Was there any sense of this? It was an embarrassment for the country on some level?
No, not really. I mean, Denmark is we're government funded, and they don't really question the stories, so to speak, whether we're being patriotic enough or whether we're saying something critical about the country. They're very helpful. We have basically two consultants who sit and choose the stories, so there are piles of stories lying around. They're very helpful in that way. It's easier than here, because it's not private funding, and also the fact that I used 14 German boys,
right,
and an unknown actor in the lead at that time. He's not unknown anymore, but
right. But thanks to you.
Yeah, but no, but they don't question that as they probably would here.
But when the film was actually done, was anybody unhappy that it was tough on?
No, but it did bring out all the historians out of their holes, and of course they wanted to debate whether it was true or whether this really happened or why there wasn't anything written about it and was this something we should be ashamed about, or is this a natural thing that happens after war, or after something terrible, that people are filled up with hate and the lust for revenge and all that? So in that sense, it brought out a great debate, so to speak, that also helped.
Was there any real resolution to the conversation, or did people make a determination whether they thought it was
No. Well, they accepted it as it was historically true, mm-hmm. that it was a part of the Danish history, and but I also received my first hate mails. So it's I think it divides, you know, the country.
Or, so do you think people are angry at you for telling the truth or for some other?
Not, I think they were, some of them were angry at me because they thought I was making an image as the Germans, as heroes, which I wasn't mm-hmm. really. I was pointing fingers at how we treat each other, mm-hmm. you know. And I think, you know, for me that was the point of the movie, so.
Well, there's that recurring, you know, they're just boys theme, even from the beginning, even when he's angry, you know, angrier at them, I guess, or more like single focused.
Yeah.
He already still is recognizing that they're children.
And he's a little bit irritated that it's children, because what to do with his hate then? He needs to get, you know. So
is that, have you, so when did you start making your next picture? And were you working on it when this was coming out, or?
No, I've just been in Japan shooting a movie with Jared Leto, and
which is financed by the Danish
government
at all,
it's
or
an
is
American,
a private
it's
American
American
movie?
Yeah, actually, I brought my editor here, so we're sitting here editing it now. Mm-hmm. Just watched the first sample yesterday.
So. And you're okay?
I'm okay. I'm still alive.
People do say that's the worst day in a director's life.
it looked good. Yeah, I'm happy.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
Is it 7 hours long at this point, or?
No, 3.5.
Okay, so that's not so bad.
No.
And you, so it's pretty much what you expected. It sounds like.
It is. It is. Yes. I've seen all the. I had seen all the dailies. So yeah. It is. It's what I expected.
So you're at peace with it. Even though you have a lot of work
you
to
never,
do.
You never know. I haven't shown it to the producers and haven't shown it to anyone yet. It's just my work now. So.
Are you enormously critical of yourself as a filmmaker? I mean, when even in a film, finished film or in process?
I am, yes. I am. I don't really see anything but the mistakes or the flaws or anything that there are in. I never get to enjoy my own movies, so the fact that it has gone so well for Land of Mine, I'm often surprised that, but don't I see that it's, you know, this and this, and but I guess that's how it is to be a filmmaker. I enjoy other directors' movies, but I don't really enjoy my own.
So you haven't got enough distance from applause yet to see it?
No, because I still remember all the I still remember all the takes. I still remember all the things that I could have done better.
So you're now a full-fledged writer director. That's your life.
Yes. That's I would say that. Yes.
Is it what you? Does it fulfill the things you think you wanted to fulfill when you were a kid making up stories?
No, I mean I would also say now it's not that I'm not even sure that I want to be a filmmaker for the rest of my life. I sometimes I also think, you know, maybe I should just open a small cafe or, you know, drink coffee and just sit around and read books. And it's also it's a hard life, you know, work long days and it you pay a big price. I mean, I'm lucky I have the family with me. My wife, my cinematographer, my kids are always with me on set. But in that sense, you know, there's also some sacrificing in it.
So you're raising a grip and a gaffer, and
maybe you never know.
But that's kind of like an amazing, actually positive story. That most people work together, it's kind of disastrous. It sounds like you guys have a pretty good groove on it.
We do. But I also because of that, my father left me. I think, you know, it's a choice that I took from very early on that I did not want to be the absent father. I wanted to be present in their lives, and they had to be around.
So is it a little easier as the financial benefits of successful movies are happening for you? Are you feeling a little more?
Totally. Yeah.
So you don't have to run away to the countryside and open a coffee shop. Quite yet.
Maybe. Not yet. Not just yet.
When it goes terribly wrong.
Yeah.
And so you fitted, has somebody fitted you for a tuxedo yet?
No, not yet. They have fitted me, but not for a tuxedo. Yeah.
They're not fighting? They're not in line to...
No, not really. I'm sure we'll get some.
So it's now been probably long, because when you opened in Toronto, you had already opened at home, I assume.
No.
Was that the world premiere?
That was the world premiere. We opened up 3 months later, 3.5 months later than Toronto, yeah.
So is there anything that's sticking with you from that experience of having made this?
From the Toronto experience?
From the whole thing of this picture happening. I mean, you've kind of like moved, it always seems like somebody's moving on to another family or another part of their life when they make the next movie, you know, it's like the next girlfriend or something. But is there something, anything sticking to your ribs in particular about Land of Mine?
Well, definitely that a local story like that mm-hmm. can become so global that mm-hmm. it seems to have opened up the eyes of and also that it shocks me a little bit that it mirrors society so much that it's become mm-hmm. more relevant than it was when it opened, which I would have hoped it would have been the other way around.
Does it play differently in any of the countries that you've gone to with it?
Yes, I think it does. I mean, people tend to like it, but it definitely, it's funny when I've seen people, you know, met people here, I met people in Japan, and met people, and of course it moves people in different ways, you know. Some have shame in them, and some mm-hmm. have forgiveness in them, and some have a feeling of the hate towards their neighbor countries. Lucky enough, it seems to be that there's a tendency when people watch it that they don't see it as Denmark and Germany, they see it as their own country, their own nations, their own, which makes me happy.
Have you seen it in Germany? Have you gone to had a German event experience with it?
I've seen it in Germany with people, and they really received it well. But it was put out by a very small distributor, so most of the Germans haven't gotten the chance to see it, which I'm a little sad about. But that's that's life.
So will it have? Is there a vigorous post theatrical life in Germany? I guess like everybody or everywhere else now.
I don't know. I don't know actually.
Is that how you see? I mean, is that how, when you were at home, when you were living in Norway, in Denmark, is that how you saw most of the films you saw, or did you go to the theater, movie theater?
I go to the theater all the time, once a week.
So you're not a DVD junkie. You wanna?
No, I'm not. I really like going into the theater, and I usually go there when I put the kids to bed. Then I drive off at 9 o'clock and say, I'm off to the theater, and the kids are always envying me. Oh, are you going to the theater again, Daddy?
So what are you liking?
I like drama. I like things that moves me. I like, you know.
Are the big action things very popular at home? Or
they are. They are. They're everywhere. But that's and I do go see that sometimes. Sometimes I also need that just to be entertained.
Do you find them entertaining?
Sometimes I do, and I think, you know, sometimes I leave. Mm. Sometimes I'm only there for 10 minutes.
Seen stuff explode enough?
Yeah.
Well, it's funny because I think they've made a real effort to bring in more interesting directors in the last couple of years. They're starting to, you know, kind of push the envelope, and I'm surprised you haven't gotten a phone call. Go do a Marvel movie.
I have. Yeah, I have. I think, you know, it's strange because there are so many filmmakers there that wants to do important movies, and yet again the cinemas tends to only want to show blockbusters and Marvel movies, and of course that's where the money is. But maybe it'll change in the next couple of years.
Do you have any interest in scaling up and trying that out?
I'm not sure. I think I am, but it depends on what the story is about and the characters and what's in it, basically.
So you're not interested in just like taking the ride and seeing what becoming a CG master is about and
the CGI? No. That's not what's in it for me, I think.
So you need the story to be something you actually want to do.
Yeah.
Hard to do with a lot of explosions.
Yeah.
And people in tights.
Yeah.
Are there any Danish superheroes?
Are there any Danish superheroes? I think there is one called Ant Boy.
Ant Boy?
Ant Boy.
Huh.
I also think it premiered over here at one point. It's a children's movie with a yeah, the boy who gets bitten by an ant, and then, yeah.
So he's like Spider-Man, but an ant version of that?
Basically.
That's fascinating. And is the Danish cinema getting better, do you think, as time goes on? Or are you feeling like, I mean, you guys certainly have a very big imprint in the Academy Awards this year and have in the last few years.
Well, it's a good question. I mean, the critics at home say that there is a crisis in Denmark, and it's a big debate in Denmark. I don't think so. I think we have an extremely pack of talented filmmakers. I think we're having a lot to say, and we want to say a lot. And I think we're out there. I think we're a good group of talented filmmakers. I think, I don't think we're becoming better. I think we've, you know, all the way from the dark. I think it's, we're a good country to make movies in.
So what do they think the crisis is?
I think they talk a lot about how many people go and watch our movies. Mm. A lot of times. Because it's also government funded, we get to experiment a lot. And I don't know how they actually or why they say it, but it probably has something to do with that we don't get enough audience.
So is the idea that the arts aren't that important and you need to make some money as opposed to culturally relevant?
Probably, yes.
That's kind of horrifying. Of course, this happens here. That's happening here too, right now. Yeah, they're trying to defund all the arts programs, and you know, we don't have a lot of it in the United States to begin with. So
no,
and it's a tiny little budget line, but it's somehow very important to kill that first.
It is, yes.
And spend more money on the military.
Yeah.
Do you guys, there's not a Danish, big Danish military at this point, is there?
I'm not aware of that. No, I don't think there is.
It's just soldiers, I guess, more than. No, yeah. Boats.
Yeah.
No really big boats.
No.
So is going through this Academy thing thrilling? Is it like you showed up at the luncheon, I guess, a couple days ago?
Yes, I was there. It's quite an experience. Surreal, you know, so to speak. It was, I enjoyed it, but it's also a surreal experience, you know, being there and exciting somehow, yeah.
Do you feel part of them? Are you like an outsider looking in?
Not really a part of them. It's also, there's, you know, people have no clue about who I am, so it's like looking at your name tag and you're like, it's fun. It's almost like being in a movie, you know.
Like a Fellini movie,
or a big Hollywood movie.
Yeah. So is it the community of filmmakers that you're in, does it feel like a community? Does it feel like you guys all are kind of in a group? Or is there, I mean, there once was more of an organizing principle, I guess.
No, it does. I mean, we're all good friends and we talk to each other and we would give advices and we read each other's scripts and go to each other's editing rooms and help each other out. I mean, I'm not saying there's no competition. Of course there is, but I think in general we like each other and we know of each other and some of us almost share offices. Mm-hmm. So and we eat and we dine and we drink together. So I like the community, the film community as it is.
And is there a next generation already nipping at your heels?
Always, or? Always, always. but that's the way it is. I mean, I'm also excited for that.
Do you crew? I mean, do you get? For instance, you're shooting in Japan. Do you get to bring much crew with you to Japan, or do you have to?
I was very, very lucky. I got to bring my production designer, my cinematographer, So my editor is editing it now. All Danish crew. I was very lucky. I also believe that a filmmaker should bring his team. I think, you know, they are the ones who understand me and understand my voice and what I want to say and see. And I think I would feel personally just difficulty in just being thrown in with different people, because would it be their taste or would it be my taste? And I think it's important that me as a filmmaker to bring my taste out, that it's my view of the story or the characters or whatever it is.
Another problem with making big Hollywood movies.
No, I'm not so sure. I mean, you know, a lot of cinematographers do Danish cinematographers over here do well over here. So yeah. I've been fortunate to bring my own.
No, I just think it's a lot. What happened? People get into this, you know, a studio thing with a big budget, and all of a sudden there are a lot of opinions that are.
Yeah, and of course, and it's fair enough. I think that's, you know. It's not that I can't do it with a different team, but I enjoy working with my own team.
So you're in the midst of, you're finishing, you're working on your post on your next movie. It sounds like you're kind of just after that, maybe a little open. You don't really know. You don't have like an idea of what your next step is or what you need your next step to be. It sounds like you're kind of going with the flow.
I'm you know, looking around, seeing.
As long as the kids are happy and the wife is happy.
Seeing what's out there. I'm open and to new things, yeah.
And you can just take your family. Have you seen Captain Fantastic?
I've seen it, yes. I love it, yeah.
You're like that, but with a wife that's alive. You're on the bus.
Yeah, exactly.
You go to Japan, you can go to
and
America.
And the kids will come here, and they will be a part of the Oscars also, and we'll afterwards, when the Oscars over, I'll drive around and show them Grand Canyon and Joshua Tree Park, and yes, it's
the world is a small place for you. I like that.
I think the world has become a small place for all of us, you know,
but not everybody takes advantage of it. A lot of people still hide in their little shelves and
yeah
kind of stay in one place. It sounds like you want to go everywhere.
Well, I want to go everywhere. I also think it's our responsibility as filmmakers to go where the story is and not focus on our own. You know, the world has. We have the same headlines in our newspapers as you do. You know, things have changed in the last couple of years.
Yeah.
So the things I want to see is the same things you want to see, luckily I'm just an airplane away.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.